toasty later. We are, in some sense, preaching to the choir here, because the set of all people who would come to a lecture about company culture is pretty much the people who want to learn about company culture. So, I'll tell you what we do. The talk is more intended for people who believe, as I did for two decades, culture is an interference in making money. So that's where I came from. And mine is a story where repeated failure prompted me to learn. But it took not just one. So where we are today is we're a chief of company. We're up the road 10, 20 miles from your farm. We're pretty close. We're in a little place called Reeseville. I bought the high school in 2003. My office is in the detention room. there's a one-way mirror looking in. The controller has the principal's office, because he's actually the guy who does important things. And what we do is we make weird cheese. And the intention is to stay doing little niche stuff. If you can pronounce the cheese, I don't want to make it. Okay. If my customers speak clear English and short declarative sentences, they're not going to last. I want customers who can barely speak English to. So we make cheese for people from Brazil and the Philippines, from India, from San Salvador, from Poland, from the the Middle East. We make kosher cheese. We make halal cheese. Just all sorts of weird stuff. Over the years, there's two pieces of this graph I want you to pay attention to. The first 20 years, when I denied feelings, and the last decade, where we got one. I am a 1.3% Jew free. I'm a nice Semitic boy who does hot, dry really well. It's not clear today why I live in Wisconsin. I moved here from New York City to make Mexican cheese to live in rural Wisconsin, not fancy. So what could go wrong? At first, I believe that what managers do is decide. Quality issues, pricing, competition, all the rest of that stuff. Things didn't go well, and I felt bad for me. Self-pity is a beautiful thing. It's not terribly useful, but it really helps you deal with yourself. But as I say, I came late to the notion that actually what managers do, they make some decisions, but the leaders are the ones who motivate. And so I started asking questions about what the devil motivation was. And I got a lot of answers, but they weren't helpful. If I felt like I was the hero in my own movie, at some point it occurred to me that probably pretty much everyone else did. And that when I felt bad probably they needed, the feelings matter. And that was a bit of a revelation. But feelings are like phlegm. Everybody has it, nobody likes to talk about it, it's sort of vaguely disgusting. And I was joking a few minutes ago with the pretty diminutive young lady Elsie, who I was saying, if she says this, it doesn't work as well as when an old hairy man rides it. All right, because if I talk about feelings, it's like, well, I don't know, he's... But if Elsie does, yeah, it's sort of a girl thing. You know, it turns out that feelings are not gender specific. They're gender neutral. We all have them. None of us particularly know how to deal with them. And at least for guys, I speak for myself, I was told to deny them, ignore them, and move on. But that's ineffective, and it's really troubling to me to this moment that the world can't be rational. But people aren't perfect, and if I figure if I screw up a few, probably people around me do too. So I gotta deal with the feelings about failure, I gotta deal with feelings. 15 years ago, I was asked by some doctors to help them organize a little venture they had started teaching people in their clinics some of the steps to getting better, lifestyle stuff, push-ups, sit-ups, walk, and all the rest of it. And those people who did it got better. And the doctor said to me, but not everybody does it. Like, they all start off this way, and then they all fail. How do we make this work? So I started a little company called Getting Better. What we did is we taught them stuff like push-ups and walking and all the rest of it. But mostly what we did, it turned out, was we talked to them about their feelings. And as we talked to them about their feelings, as we acknowledged the reality, these were people, big boys and girls. The men were generally, the men body weight average was 400 pounds. The girls were between 280 and 350. Big boy girls, chronic illness, morbid obesity. The last thing they needed was somebody in a doc's office in a white coat to say, you know, you really should lose weight. No shit, Sherlock. Wow. What they wanted was to feel good about themselves. So I asked the docs how you do that, and they did. I don't know, it wasn't the doc type of thing. So we did a program, we did it for 5 years, and it worked. It was a little about diet, a little about exercise, and it was a lot about talking about your feelings. So we'd have a small group, and we'd set a ground rule, you can't make fun of each other, and we'd talk about feelings, and talk about brownies, and talk about sleeping, and talk about a little bit of tactics, and a lot about this is what it's like to be a human. It's okay. There's nothing to be ashamed of. And once people are able to get over shame, then they're able to accept facts. But until you get them over shame, they're going to deny facts. That was not a political statement. It couldn't. So, I did 5 years before we published some stuff in certain medical journals. I went to the health insurance and I got a great idea, I can really help with chronic obesity. What do you think you pay for it? They said no. I mean, and surprise, surprise, it takes 15 years for a medical insurer to take on a new program. They said, well, you know, I got a cheese company. Maybe this stuff would work at our place. So I took some of those lessons and brought them back to my cheese company. And as I started, me bumbling, not trained, what I heard was, farm folk don't do feelings. Oh, okay, I think I know this movie. It's at least I know the tune. So I took some time to try to talk to the staff. And what I heard from them is, we don't like to talk about feelings, just like me, because we don't understand them, and we feel powerless when they come up. We get reduced to simpering children. I'd much rather squash it, quash it, pull the garage door down on them, broom it, deny it. It's way easier that way. It may not be effective, but boy, I feel like a real man. The problem is that I wasn't getting what I wanted to from them, and they from their people. We were giving clear instructions, but we weren't dealing with feelings. So, I asked a bunch of these medical professionals, so what are feelings? That was not a productive line of report. We got some neuroscience, it comes from the amygdala in the back of the brain. Thanks, does that mean if I had a screwdriver I could fix it? No, so what are feelings? Well, when your tummy feels bad, you're not on your game. Really. Help me. What do you do about feelings, Duff? Professionals. Somebody ask. What's enjoyment? And this for me, as I'll point out in a moment, is the big insight. Pleasure is not the opposite of pain. Motivation is not simply going from pain to pleasure. there's more to it. Can you enjoy the hard work of bicycling? Let's try those words. Can you enjoy hard work? Can you enjoy all bread? Really? Can you enjoy repetitive, monotonous effort, peeling a potato? Can you enjoy it? There's something more going on. So I figured that if I'm going to deal with feelings, I've got to learn what they are, I've got to learn about pain, pleasure, and motivation. And what I found out is that there's a third element. There's pain, there's pleasure, and there's excitement. There's getting a rush. It's not the same. So I talked to a bunch of neuro people, and it turns out that there are different brain circuits. There's a brain circuit for pleasure, there's a brain circuit for excitement, there's a brain circuit for pain. And pain gives you a rush. Anybody here think of a person in their life who loves drama? They know it's going to be destructive, they know it's not going to be good, but they like it. They want the rush. We are motivated by three things. So if there's one slide I ask you to remember, that's it. It's not in English, because feelings are way pre-verbal. There are three motivators for all people. Universal law, whoa! People are motivated to get out of these negative feelings first. Then they're motivated to seek excitement. Anything with an exclamation point is exciting. So if it really hurts, people are motivated. They want a rush. And finally, lastly, they like pleasure. Curiosity, gratitude, love, yeah, whatever. Those are sort of the luxury items of motivation. If you want people to do stuff, you have to avoid giving them pain and shame. You have to give them an opportunity for a rush and encourage them to have a rush. So I say that very broadly, and the intent is to say that's the way you can motivate teams and people. There's an open question. Can you create a productive company where people are both accountable and you avoid putting them into pain and shame? Right? I don't know if you're aware of this, but in China, there is literally a popular management technique, which is you get whole big management meetings in a public auditorium, and the ones who fail are brought up on the stage, their trousers are pulled down, and they're spanked. Whoa! Is that effective motivation? And the answer evidently is yes. I got no research to say it's good or bad. I can only say it's my company, I'm not doing that shit. I don't want to work in that place. But it is an open question. Can you be nice? Can you try to avoid pain and shame? Give people a chance for a rush. Give them, encourage them to pleasure and be productive. So think about Simon's example. Guy comes in, new employee, first day, goes off to lunch, comes back, he's 2 minutes late. Clearly, one way to motivate the guy is to say, hey, look dipshit, everybody else at work, where the hell are you? There's another way. Everybody got a pen? Okay, write down five words. Because this is what we do. This is what I teach. This is the way our company operates. It happens all the time. People come in and they do something dumb. Safety? Goals, facts, plan, help. Safety, goals, facts, plan, help. And here now, here's Simon on his block. Safety, goals, facts, plan, help. Safety, look, man, I wish you the best in this world. You're new here, I really hope you stay. If you don't, I'm gonna wish you the best. You're okay, I'm gonna give you some negative feedback here. I want you to stay. But you're okay. Our goal is to have the whole team work together. And the whole team can't work together if you're not here. We started 2 minutes ago. And the fact is, you weren't here. Do you agree? Because, as many of you probably know, there are going to be people who look at you 5 after the hour and say, no, I'm not late. No, I wasn't here at 5 past. It takes an intellectual to say, you're right, I was here 2 minutes late. But that's not a shared fact.
That does happen.
That does happen. Okay, so you're saying, do we share the same goal? Do we all want the team to work together? And again, we have people who are saying, oh, no, there's an exit. But presumably Simon would have said, yeah, no good. And the fact that you're 2 minutes late, I'm not sure if I told you. Because there's no video of what I told you or didn't tell you, but as your boss, now you know. You got it, you're on time or early. And we only pay you from 1 o'clock on. So there's a couple of minutes when you're going to be standing around twiddling your thumbs, not on the clock, that's part of the job. At 1 o'clock, the line starts, you got it. Got it? Now, let's make a plan. The plan is, what are you going to do tomorrow at starting? Can you get here or not? Can you have lunch? What do I need to do to help you be here on time? And if Simon starts to tell me, oh, my alarm clock doesn't go off, and this, and I'm like, my dog ate my homework, and all the usual bullshit, you may need to get help. You may need to say, look, Simon, let's go over to the human resource department, let's go to my boss, what have you. But if the tone of Simon's first interaction at 104, whatever it was not, hey, you jerk, but rather, hey, I really want this to work out, you're safe. Right, you know, counterfactual. I bet you listening. Can you make a place work where the first rule is safety? Yours. So what do you do when you fire somebody? Look, Jack, come on in. I wish you the best in this world. I'm imperfect, you're imperfect, and I really feel like I feel bad because it's not going to work. Wait, what do you mean? No, it's not going to work. It's done. You cannot protest. It's done, but I wish you the very best. So, please give me your key or whatever, or walk you out, or whatever it may be. But it starts with, I wish you the best. Because I do. And the word for that, the multi-syllable word is compassion. But the price of compassion is individual responsibility. There is a price. And if I can't figure out how to get us there, I move along. But I have to run an accountable organization which feels safe. You gotta know the rules. I lose my temper, and I apologize. I'm just a guy, I'm not even particularly good. It's just people, right? So since we're all imperfect, we're gonna try to work together, make a compassionate place where we wish each other safety, but we're individually responsible. So, chronic or getting better, chronic illness, how do you motivate people, how do you motivate sick patients, how do you motivate people at work? The first piece is you get them out of shame and fear. This is what I expect. We're all folks. People make mistakes. Wait, if that's the game, Paul, isn't there someone who can game the game? They keep making mistakes because you know you're a softie. The answer is yes. So I take a risk with every person I hire. And the way I measure the risk is repetition. I assume you have good intentions and that we're going to work together. Now this is the third time we've had this conversation about 102. It is 102, right? And you know, you're right, I have forgiven you the prior time of this time. I'm writing you up. And if I write you up a second time, that will be the last time you get a write-up, because the third time you're out. And I have sat in one of our, I've stood in one of our cheese plants, and there's a little button on what's called a finishing bag. And since people touch it all the time, it's dirty. So you say, if you touch the button, you've got to go wash your hands. And I've stood there, and the guy says, hey, he does it again. 5 minutes later, I walk out to the little desk, I write it up and say, whatever this guy's name was, you know, you can't do it, sign right here, that I told you. I'm not going to sign that. Did I tell you? Yeah, well, then just say, I told you. Okay, sign. Minutes later. And I bring him over, I sit him at the desk, do you understand? Write this down, sign here. That's your last warning. I fired him in 20 minutes. I went through the whole process. Right? This is... But the flip side of that is, everybody else is watching. I'm not losing my cool. It's pretty much a bloodless thing. The facts are the facts. Do we share the same goal? That's dirt. If you touch it and don't wash, you're going to make bad cheese. Was he drugged? Was he, I don't know. But I couldn't figure out a way to work with him. What happened? The tone and manner of the company is one which I really want this to work. And I can't stress enough, I really feel that I want you to do well in this world. I'm a deeply flawed person. I wish you the best. I'm trying. I can't figure it out. Go with God's peace. If we can work together, what you need is a rush. And there's a strategy to give every man, woman, and child a rush, and it's called a goal. A measurable goal. Do you know what you're doing? Because people they measure themselves all the time. Is it clear what they're supposed to do? Can you measure it? People are going to get off on it. Because I did a good job. They can self-grade. And literally. So we've got people who clean bathrooms. And they're proud of themselves because the bathrooms are clean. How do you know? There's nothing on the floor. There's this little swab. Did those stereo swabs come back? If you can give people a feeling of safety and measurable goals, in my view, you're 90% of the way towards motivation. Avoid out. Seek arousal. And then, I think this is supposed to say, get off. So it turns out there's a researcher at the University of Wisconsin, Barb Frederick, and she has studied what drives pleasure. Okay, cool, let's go read what Barb says. Barb says, here they are in alphabetical order. These are the things. And what I do is walk around saying, are you having fun yet? Because if you're not having fun, there is something wrong in your productivity. If you aren't curious, then I got a problem. How do you do better? So the way I solicit this is every 90 days I sit down with all the supervisors, they having sat down with all their people, and we review their goals where there is one objective. The objective of those meetings is for those people to be able to ask the owner, how can the owner help them achieve their goals? Every 90 days. Okay, you know what? People enjoy the meetings and they enjoy the process of thinking about how they can get better. That's what we do. It seems to be effective. The problem is in my case, when the other person has messed up, the thing I want to do is scream and blame at them. So I have to do a little mental gymnastics in the area of when I find myself blaming, I'm taking the locus of control out from me and putting it over there. It's your fault. I have no agency now. I feel bad, right? Actually, I feel self-pity. See, it's him. See, it's really not my fault. See? But I'm powerless now. Blame is a way of taking control and outsourcing. So the alternative to blame is some sort of shared guilt. You may react with anger, but you can do better. You did screw up. But so did I. Somehow, I don't quite see But we're, it's a team. We're together. Something happened. And I'm going to choose to have faith that you can do better. You're miserable, right? Because there's no big surprise you screwed up. But I can choose to see more in you than you see in yourself. And my experience is people react to that consistently. I got stories on stories about how people will grow to the point of your expectation. And if you believe that pretty much, if you believe that pretty much everyone can do your job, that you're just an ordinary, average guy, they're all sort of the same. I got lucky. They can become, they can do better. They'll do it. They'll get there. If we can learn to manage our own feelings, we can learn to motivate others. People are imperfect. I'd offer you the two words, reactions and responses. With my kids, I used to call it spaz attacks. People react, and sometimes our reactions are bitter, ugly, and quick, right? You damn fool, you ignorant slut, you, you know, Jane, what was it, Jane? Jane, ignorant. Remember Saturday Night Live? Jane, but we react, including me, we react. And then, oh, it's then a real adult says, I'm sorry. That wasn't justified. My mouth went ahead of my brain. Now I have a response. It's a slow, it's a deliberately quick response. It's boring, it's dull, it means you drive the speed limit. Yeah, that's right, that's about what you want in a leader. The second most important slide that I'm going to show is up here now. If it is true that all human motivation can be aligned and arranged on three dimensions, getting out of fear, fear of physical pain, fear of emotional rejection, shame, seeking a rush, arousal, and pleasure. If it is true, then where are all the other bad feelings? And the insight I'd offer you is that all bad feelings stem from fear. That's a mammoth concept. Somebody is sad, somebody's angry, somebody's disgusted, somebody's bored. They're all coming out of fear. Your brain doesn't have a separate little system for sadness, and a different one for regret, and a different one for disgust. Those are human words to describe a concatenation of feelings. It's our interpretation of the current situation and what's going on inside us. That means that if you can be a place where people feel safe, the company will be an enjoyable one to work with. It's a safe place. I will just assert that most of the people who work for us say, this is the safest place in my life. It is safer than my home, it is safer than my wife, it is safer than my community, it is safer than my church, because they don't feel shame. I'm not, on a farm there really are big things that drop and hurt you. In my cheese factory, the biggest thing is it hurt, fall, and drop you a little bit. So physical pain is not as big a deal, but shame is. And we work really, really hard to make this a place where when people make mistakes, we work together to get better. We don't blame, we don't shame. And the output is people want to stay. Okay. If all bad feelings come from fear, then the question is how do you manage fear? So now we're going to do an exercise here, a fruity little thing called meditation. All right? But in our written procedures, is the word breathe. So whenever something bad happens, the first thing we say to the other person is, take a deep breath. And this is the way it goes. Take a deep breath. Take a deep breath. If the other person can't take a deep breath, you send them for a timeout, just like you did with your kids. Go punch out, go in the break room, and when you can take a deep breath, come back. care. Go now. Take a deep breath. Until you can take a deep breath, all that is controlling that person's behavior is the amygdala. This is not on. And conversely, the act, not of breathing, but the act of deciding to take a deep breath, is the cortex taking the blood, taking the energy. And the cortex is the antagonist of this amygdala. If you can decide to take a deep breath, you're back. Good to have you back. Spaz attack is done. Until you can, I don't want to talk to you because I don't know what I got. It's the animal part of you. So we have a procedure. Take a deep breath. Okay, so we're gonna try it. Step one, take a deep breath. So we're gonna do a breathing exercise. Sit, please. Put your both feet on the floor, you're gonna do some eyes closed stuff. It'll take all of 60 seconds. But what it asks me to do right now is do an internal check of your sensations. And presumably they're gonna be a little bit more prickly and on than they will be in 60 seconds. Get comfortable, close your eyes, roll your shoulders from front to back, pull them down, and then forward, once more, back, and down, and forward. Put your hand on your belly, please. Take a slow, deep breath in. Fill your lungs all the way so that your belly starts to come out. Feel your belly push against your hand. Slowly release your deep breath. The slower you release the breath, the better. And now again, take a deep breath in. And slowly let it out. Once more. Deep breath in and slowly let it out. Okay, open your eyes. Anatomically, your blood pressure is lower than it was 60 seconds ago. But I ask you, can you sense the difference in your body? You feel different? Tom, you there? Jason? Feeling different? There's no magic, there's hardly an invention, right? But what if this was a thing in your management? It's effective. Crazy, fruity, and effective. Okay, so something bad has happened. That pallet of cheese that was, and now it's on the floor, and it's bad, and there's some worked up and the customer wants it, and whatever the situation, we've taken a deep breath. Step number two, somebody's afraid. Somebody's afraid of consequences, afraid of something. This word is so short and so hard. So is the cheese saleable?
Well, it might be. There's no bite about it, it just is on the floor.
We're going to have right? This is accepting the facts. Hi, my daughter's name is Laura. She's now 35. Hi, sweetheart. 20 years ago, the car is where? You're safe, okay? And the car is where? Okay, but you're safe. Where is the car? Right? Acceptance, really hard. And worse, if you feel like you're in a place where if things are bad, you're gonna get screwed. Much easier if, again, okay, the boss doesn't fire people. This is a tough place to get fired. It's a screw-up. All right, what are we gonna do to fix it so it doesn't happen again? In me, I am constantly fighting my reactive nature to my deliberative nature. So this little proverb is one I keep in mind. This says, a little boy asks the elder. The old man tells the youngster about a wolf and the wolf inside of him. One wolf pulls him, saying, you are bad, you should be better. The anxious, self-doubting wolf. And the other wolf says, you're okay. You've fixed problems before, you'll fix them in the future. And the little kid asks, so which wolf wins? And what I offer is the one you feed. It is a choice. Our behavior as leaders is our own choice. There are excuses for reactions, but not for responses. We can create the organization that we want. We can create the team that we want. It's a bloody pain in the neck, and I wish it weren't true, because I just want to make things happen. I want people to be perfect. I want reason to be vivid. But none of that's right. It's a choice. It can happen. It can work for me. I think it can work for you. If you can't say you've been part of the problem, then you can't say how can we work together for a better future. Once people are out of fear, once people are into, we've accepted the facts, then we can be curious. How do we work together? Hello, Jesse, July 11th, this year. Yeah, we paid for the Spang Creek plans. Yep, that's the appraisals in. Yep. $6.1 million loan. How'd the committee? Jesse, I like you a lot, but I don't like your facts. Loan is rejected. $250 million of engineering down the drain. 2-year delay. This is true. Okay. Acknowledging that sucks. I feel real bad. This is going to hurt. We've been through worse before. How are we going to work together for the future? I found curiosity. I'm practicing this because I've made so many mistakes in life. But once I get to curiosity, we'll be fine. My objective, really truly, right now, August 12th, a month later, is to make our family, my company and my literal family, feel like it was better that the bank rejected the loan. How are you going to do that? That's curiosity. Cool. I got out of fear. I have a goal. I'm curious. Now I'm ready. I'm going to keep going. This is an example which is, if you haven't had it happen to you, it's happened to me any number of times. Paul, you're an idiot. Okay, that is what Joe just said. That's what he's calling me. You don't pay me enough to do this crap. In my case, I was told, I'm a narcissist. I'm so proud of myself. I'm not worth being alive. I should, there were some insults that came with it. Well, this turns out there's only two types of feedback in the universe. Constructive and raw. Right? Okay, so, he did just say that. Take a deep breath. Yeah, that is what he said. You're an idiot, you're a narcissist, you're a fool, you're whatever. Okay. He didn't throw a fist, threw an insult. Let's see if I can find out what's going on. To find out what's going on, I gotta make the other guy feel safe. So I find my curiosity. What? How could he say that? And once I'm there, I'm okay. So look, Bill, Joe, Fred, what's going on? What are you talking about? And then comes the word, the word storm. And it's generally incoherent. Because if somebody's come to the boss and is insulting them to his face, you're probably not going to get slow, deliberate paragraphs of reason. But you may learn something. And again, either it's constructive feedback or it's wrong. We have video cameras in all of our rooms, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Guy comes into me and he says, your supervisor sucked. Excuse me? What? Your supervisor sucked. What? And starts, the story starts with, well, I had to get a sandwich, but it ends with big bad water fight last night. Big bad water fight last night. Tell me more. Yeah, it was 11:04. He's off and running. And it's bullshit. There's video cameras. So he sits down the next morning with the client manager, turns on the video cameras, and says, you said 11:04? Yeah, 11:04. Okay. I don't see any view. Yeah, it's right there. No, wait, I'm looking at the same TV set you are. So don't share the same time you're wrong. I don't think we can work together. I wish you the very best. Okay, so now we get to the second and last piece here. Simon mentioned it, I will offer it. There is a choice in our lives about how, what we assume about other people. The risky assumption is to assume everybody is good with some intentions. It's clearly false. There are people who we have employed, who we meet, who don't have good intentions. But if the assumption is that most people don't, then you're going to create an atmosphere of shame and faith and fear. If the assumption is you have good intentions until proven otherwise, we're going to take it in the chin every now and then. The video camera, two of my supervisors punching each other in on alternative days while the other guy came in 20 minutes later, that hurts. And you ask, guys, you knew there was a video camera at the time clock. What did you expect from me? But there was no question about intentionality. Repetitive, you did it. Good luck to you. See you later. Most of the time, most of the people, I assume, are good intentions. Which means I can ask how we work together. And that makes it makes for a place that I like being in. I don't know if this is directly relevant, but we talked, Simon, about value. And for me, the value of the buildings that we create, of the concrete, of the walls, genuinely, I don't think it has any more endurance than a random act of kindness. The mom who stays home, who is nice to her son, who grows up to be the president, where does her productivity get measured? I don't get it, I don't know how, but I try to live by the belief that kindness is the top priority. And we have strategies to make stuff happen. That's a risk, that's what we do. A few years ago, our company was not doing well. Now it is doing nicely. We're very pleased with it. I can put up this graph, which says that since we started teaching emotional intelligence in the workplace, our retention has soared. It used to be that I'd hire 5 people and have 1 stay. Now it's I hire 5 people and 4 stay. We have a waiting list. We have more applicants than we have jobs. We have more people than we need. It's an unusual business that we operate. So that's the last slide. This is the way that we run our business. It is printed on the back of my business card. I hope it has come across as simple. We try to make each other feel safe. We try to have the same goals. We look carefully to see if we have the same facts. We make a plan to go forward together. It is based in this notion that we're all imperfect. There were just folks. They were all basically average and all basically just like one another. And we try, we screw up and we act and, okay, after the end of the self-pity and the blame, let's go do something. What do you want to do together? What do you want to do together? Let's go make it happen. And we keep doing it time and again. Same thing. As my 2-year-old granddaughter says, done. Any questions, please?